We're in the studio today with Professor Dr. Robin Cosford to talk about the health system. We've been talking about integrated medicine and nutrition and those sort of things, but today we're going to talk more specifically about the World Health Organization and what it's planning to implement globally, and in that case, bring in Australia under its canvas. And it's a little concerning. I don't think many people are fully aware of what's really going on. So Robin, I'm going to try and sit back and let you talk to this, because this is a really textured topic. So go for it. What's the bottom line?
What's the bottom line here? So for people, it's very confusing for most people. In fact, it's confusing for many of the freedom people who've even been looking at this. And that is that what the WHO are doing is they are simultaneously running two paths. So they are running one path to put out a world, what's the fancy name of it, Pandemic Prevention Preparedness and Response Accord. So a treaty for that. Pandemic treaty, we'll shorten it to. They put out a pandemic treaty, which they had a run at last year and it failed. And I'll tell you why it failed. But pandemic treaty, but they are simultaneously running 307 proposed amendments to another arm called the International Health Regulations. So this is what's getting people confused. They think, oh, it's just about the pandemic treaty. No, it's not. It's both. And they are both very important. So background history, WHO started in 1948 from Second World War, mm-hmm. and originally started off, took over the League of Nations. And it was just all about trying to bring health to all the disadvantaged in the world. And yes, certainly we can run through and see in their history, they've done a lot of great programs. That is certainly the case. Once we start coming to around, we start seeing the implementation of mass vaccinations that started in the 1970s, 1974. They started pushing hard mass vaccinations, TB, polio, followed with measles. What's really interesting is to see that 15 years after the push for the mass vaccination, suddenly HIV appears across all of Africa. So then there's a thing of needing to deal with the programs for HIV. So these programs are all continuing in the background. Then we start seeing another change coming in around 2000. So SARS-1, 2002-2003. So after SARS-1, 2002-2003, so prior to that time, the WHO would talk about pandemics. And pandemics had phases, had stages. Phase 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is getting a bit scary. 6 is, everything's happened, it's really bad. And they used to give warnings to countries and things about what phase we are at. So that used to be how it would work with pandemics. And the original definition of pandemic was a disease that was widespread, it was crossing international boundaries, and it was severe, affecting a lot of people, and it was severe.
Yep.
Remember the severe bit. So we come to SARS-CoV-2, SARS-CoV-1, 2002-2003. And after that, there's a shift, and WHO starts deciding that we need to bring out some more rules. So there had been a thing called the International Health Sanitation Rules. That got upgraded to the International Health Regulations in 2005. Now, in the background of all of this, we've had more money coming into WHO from what's now being affectionately called everywhere the public-private or private-public partnerships.
PPPs.
So what's happening is WHO, instead of just being funded by the countries who are contributing to WHO, suddenly, guess who the second biggest funder is? It's the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So suddenly you see the figures say that 80% of the total funding is now coming from these PPPs, from these private companies that are feeding in. So obviously we know private companies work for one reason. They work for profit. That's what they work for. You're shocked to hear that? So it should be PPPP, shouldn't it? You know, private, public, anyway, we won't go there. So we have a change in the funding into WHO. We have an apparent change that starts to come in the leanings of what the money and the effort is being put into. We start seeing change in regulations. So the International Health Regulations come in, get ratified, 2005. Now, what people don't realise is the International Health Regulations already have placed legal requirements on the countries. There are already, under the IHR, legal requirements on the countries, and those legal requirements are that the countries have to notify WHO of when there is an issue of concern. The countries are required within 24 hours to do that, and the countries are required to consider what WHO says needs to be done. So what's interesting then is to look at, well, what's been the pattern of what's happened since then, remembering that prior to that time, WHO worked on this pandemic category thing, where it would say, okay, we now have a pandemic, all right, you know, so on. But the terminology changed again. And with the IHR, WHO brought in a new category of things. It was called PHEIC, Public Health Emergency of International Concern. Okay, so PHEIC is not pandemics. So PHEICs. Again, putting in context here, WHO acknowledged that last century there was thought that there would only be about one pandemic every decade or so. They were not.
Under the definition, yeah.
Under the original definition, they weren't that common. Since 2005, so we're not even 20 years, we are 18 years, well, not even that really, there have been seven PHEIEs declared. Not 70 years, many times over. And they are occurring with increasingly closer.
So it seems to me that the WHO has morphed over time, become a more dominant organisation. Is that fair?
Absolutely. They have really quite changed from an organisation that really was in very much governmentally involved and seeking to bring in programs. I think for many years, WHO was genuinely for the health of the countries, and their programs would support that. But then as we see the introduction of the PPPs, the private-public partnerships.
Well, follow the money, right?
It's the old thing, follow the money. These are corporations who are there to make money. And so they are looking for opportunities to create sale of product.
But Australia funds, I think, around 36, 37 million last time I checked to WHO. I mean, other countries, huge amounts of money,
right.
Plus these PPPs. So these guys are cashed up, right?
Their budget for 2021, I think it was $7
billion.
Oh, God.
So $7 billion.
It's a reasonable amount of money.
But they're becoming more forceful. I mean, and when I was growing up, you looked at the WHO and the UN and those sort of, you know, you looked up to them. But I don't anymore. But they've become a different organisation, which is what you're giving us the backstory there.
Yes.
So where are they going? I mean, from what I can tell.
Yeah, this becomes the concern, and you can see where they're going. And I was starting to touch into this when you look at the pattern of what they've been doing and declaring as PHEICs since 2005.
So the seven and the increasing frequency and so on.
Seven PHEICs, public health emergencies of international concern. So if you think that through, a public health emergency of international concern, you would think that would mean to need to be a pretty big event, wouldn't you? A pretty big event. So the first one they declared was 2009, the swine flu. They declared that when the swine flu was still only at a phase three of the pandemic stages. Okay. It had not really met the criteria at the time they called it of being in multiple countries at a high level causing severe disease. But they called it, and those who were around at that time would remember that all the governments were frantically were being told, you've got to stockpile these injections, you've got to stockpile the Tamiflu. And there was one European country, the president of whom was a female, stood up at the time and said, I'm just not going to do this. And of course, it was subsequently shown the vaccine was not only ineffective, it was withdrawn. And the Tamiflu was ineffective. So that was 2009. Then they did polio. They've done Ebola twice in two different countries. They've done Zika. And then we come up to SARS-CoV-2. And, of course, the last one they tried, monkeypox.
Yes.
Yeah, monkeypox. And, of course, that one didn't fly, did it? You know, the recognition that this simply did not meet any of the criteria. Now, the other issue of concern, not only did it not meet any of the criteria, it was not causing, so it wasn't severe, It wasn't multi-country, yeah. although it did make it into the US and London. The first cases occurred in London, But the big issue of concern is that, so the IHR has another, so all these lovely letters, EC, Emergency Committee. And the emergency committees are a committee that's formed at the time of the emergency and are supposed to include representatives of the countries on whom the emergency is going to be placed. So they didn't place this emergency on UK where it was found or on US where it travelled to. The emergency got placed on West Africa. Mm. But the other concern here, this emergency committee is supposed to be an advisory committee that advises on whether or not a PHEIC is going to be called. Mm-hmm. This committee met. Six of them said, yes, we should. Nine said, no, it is not a PHEIC. Six versus nine. 2 days later, Tedros
he had the call. He had the call, didn't he?
But
it was a captain's call, was it?
But if you look at it, he totally overrode the committee. It's not that he had a casting vote. That wasn't a casting.
No, it's an autocracy.
That was an autocracy. So what that showed is that already, under the existing regulations, Tedros is declaring PHEICs where he chooses, regardless of the advisory committee.
Yeah, and of the real impact.
And of the real severity. It had nothing to do with the severity of the situation. So how do we track that? You can track that further by looking, well, what was the vaccine status at the time? Okay, there were a couple of countries that were geared up to rapidly making, there is no monkeypox per se vaccine, but they decided that the smallpox vaccine was going to do nicely, thank you, based on trials back in the 1980s that hadn't showed an 85% crossover. So it's like, okay, well, that'll do. So they ramp up and make money on
this is who they've become or are becoming, and now they're running these two
strategies. So SARS-CoV-2 comes out. We have a paper published in The Lancet, a paper published in the BMJ criticising WHO, saying it wasn't good enough. So WHO, this is just what WHO needed. So WHO turn around and say, yes, we are going to strengthen everything. So they then hold a meeting of all their member countries and say, right, well, you know, let's get a new pandemic treaty. This is the pandemic prevention preparedness response thing. Yeah. New pandemic treaty in place. So they start doing the drafts for that. First attempt at getting it through last year failed, because now the thing about the pandemic treaty is that the pandemic treaty, because it's a new treaty, requires 2/3 majority vote.
And they didn't get the support
of your African countries. So they didn't get that support on the first round. So they're back to the drawing board on the pandemic treaty.
But I think it's interesting because the people who had a lot to do with them, the African nations, went, no way.
We're not backing it. Because the thing of what they're trying to put in the pandemic treaty is to make it legal. Mm. That the countries who are in it have to follow what the WHO says. Mm. So interestingly, also in that group who aren't supporting it being legal is the US. Europe is supporting it. Europe, UK are the predominant ones supporting it. A couple of the African nations, but US are not.
They made noises of supporting it and then they backed out of it.
US are not supporting it.
Yeah, that's good.
What about
Australia?
Australia's not in the supporting, so I'm not sure that we're actually not supporting. We're just not mentioned.
So
I think we abstained. We're in the, look, we don't want to put our heads up, but we've got to start putting our head up. So that's separate to the IHR. Now, the thing about the IHR, which is why the WHO are pushing the IHR, International Health Regulations, is that they only need, because there is an existing International Health Regulations in place, they only need a 50% vote to get the changes through. That's a lot less.
So these are the amendments.
These are the amendments. 307 proposed amendments to the IHR.
Which can have almost as much teeth as the treaty. Is that what you're suggesting?
It'll have more teeth than the
treaty. So 50% to make it advance.
Yeah, 307.
Global ramifications, yeah?
Yeah. And so to summarise the international health regulations, that's why I went into the background first, because if all you did is pick up the international health regulations and a commentary from someone like me saying this is what it means, you'll go, well, they're not going to do that. They can't do that. That's not. But if you look at the history and see the changes, and particularly note and remember, Tedros unilaterally called a PHEIC for a non emergency, non-serious disease.
I don't think anyone would be surprised at what happens these days. We might not have thought this 5 years ago or 3 years ago. So what does this look like? I mean, if they get the 50% and they address the 300...
If they get the 50% and they put it through, there are many levels of concern with this international health regulations. The first and the biggest one is that they are taking out the whole of our basis of human rights. Human rights, human dignity that got enshrined in our declarations post-Second World War. They are literally striking it out and replacing it with words like equity, and I forget some of the other words, I'd have to look it up, but very, let's say, vague woke left terminology, but very vague terms. It's like, well, what the heck does that mean? But they are literally striking out those things.
So that would make the constitutions of most countries subordinate to that.
That's the first thing. There are separate statements that says that in this, every country will be legally required to follow what the WHO says. So no longer it'll be mandated, not suggested. It is no longer a suggestion that you follow this, you must. You are legally required.
So if we were to roll along with this as a country and adopt these or be forced to adopt these amendments, not opt out of it, we are transferring our sovereignty to,
absolutely,
to World Health, from a health point of view, but it's beyond health.
It's beyond health, because the next things that they've put in their amendments is that once WHO declares a PHEIC, which Tedros can do at his whim, at any time, on his own decision, we've just seen him do it with monkeypox.
Well, he has some history as well, which...
He has an interesting history back in Ethiopia, if people want to go looking, and interesting connections with the CCP. So it's interesting stuff there. Yeah. If Tedros calls a PHEIC in the country he chooses, let's say he decides to choose Australia, he's going to call a PHEIC on Australia. That means we have to fund all of this. So what do we have to fund? Tedros then tells us all these manufacturing units have to be devoted to manufacturing masks, manufacturing PCR tests, manufacturing ventilators, manufacturing whatever they decree our manufacturing resources have to go to making.
At our cost.
Think of the war effort. It's exactly what's done in war, you know, where the government says, right now, we're going to make you make all these things, except that happens to be war usually that we're fighting to protect ourselves. Well, we will be decreed, we must spend all those resources.
This is what concerns me when I've looked at this, and I'm trying to navigate. There's so much information coming through on this, so it's good to get a kind of a bottom line on it. The transfer of sovereignty, or the abdication of sovereignty to an international non-elected group, which is in partnership with, you know, foundations like the Gates one, and other groups.
And the Wellcome Trust there.
Yeah. I mean, why? Why would a country like Australia or New Zealand or Fiji or wherever, why would you do that?
Well, exactly. There is no why unless we simply are not awake to what it means.
Right.
There is literally nothing for us to gain. It is all risk. There's nothing for us to gain. And it's not only that they're a non-elected government body. It'd be bad enough if it was an international emergency committee making the decisions as a committee. But we've just seen it's not the committee making decisions. It's the Director General, Tedros, making the decisions.
Yeah. So what's the status and / timeline for this now? Because they've been debating this the last month or so. April 17, is it? Is that today?
Yep. There's another meeting being called on April 17. Originally they had it for May, but I think they might have pulled that one forward. With everything with the WHO is a moving target, like they're changing definition of vaccines and they're changing definition of pandemics. Everything's a moving target. If that does get approved, I suspect there'll need to be another meeting. We then will have 6 months from when it's approved, where it gets ratified by the individual countries. There will be 6 months in which time we could pull out.
So it's an opt-out option for Australia.
Only 6 months.
Yeah, for Australia, New Zealand, et cetera, et cetera. And if any country doesn't opt out, you're bound.
You're bound legally from then on.
You're cooked.
You're cooked, absolutely. Mm. So it's not only about the manufacturing goods. It's also about intellectual property. They can take all intellectual property on whatever areas they believe that they want or they need. There is also the enforcing, and this is a big one when we think about personal rights, the enforcing of diagnostic investigations, the forcing of vaccinations, the forcing of treatment.
When you say the forcing, so coming into a country and say you will do this and you will give vaccination.
And the country is required to enforce what WHO says must be done.
Otherwise it breaches international law and there are ramifications and penalties for that, right? So, okay, so you are losing control of your health system.
Totally losing control of the health system.
So someone watching this, they go, okay, well, what does this mean for me? I have a family, I have kids. So if this was something that happened and we were a part of it and we don't opt out, then doctors, medical professions will be directed from on high? Is that?
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, cool.
Okay. Doctors and medical professionals will be directed on high and they will have to comply at their own peril, if you like. But I believe that this will be a situation where we will see the military called in to enforce that.
Okay.
Because IHR has that power. Because the country is required to enforce it.
So if you're watching this and thinking, what sort of country do we live in now? We've gone through 2 or 3 years of really significant change. And there is a total control system being implemented in all sorts of areas. And this is an example. Most people, as you're saying, Robin, they're just not across some of the nuances of this. And it's clever. And it's
very
like
clever.
You just described a parallel strategy. But once it lands and it's in cement and you can't get out. Yeah.
Exactly. Once it lands, it lands. So we our politicians don't understand.
No, they don't.
This is so strategic how they've done it like this. So it's only because I literally sat down and I spent 4 hours poring over everything I could pore over to pull together a 1.5 hour lecture that I presented last night that I actually could see all of this myself and thought, my goodness.
Yeah. But even the name of that document, you know, it's like 5 miles long.
That's right.
And so I'm a politician, I'm busy, you know, I've got to be in the house and blah, blah, blah. And I get a document like that describing with 173 pages, and can you read it? And I go, I don't think so.
That's right.
I'll trust you because you're the WHO. That's what's going on. Because I've talked to some people and they've said, the politicians do not understand this.
No, they don't.
And the media's not even, have you? I've not seen any media on this.
I've not seen any media on it either.
Yeah, I mean, this is a significant event.
It's huge.
It's incredible, isn't it?
It's absolutely huge. Mm-hmm. So thank you for talking to me on it because I'm now quite passionate that this information has to get out. Yeah. People need to understand.
All right, well, thanks for being with us. And we'll put in the details below some of the links for this presentation that you're doing because most people won't want to spend an hour and a half or 2 hours, but if you're interested in the detail, it'll be there. And we do need to be across the detail. Yeah. And you're saying this is a moving target.
It's an absolute moving target. And also the links for the website that has been put up out of South Australia, Australia Exits the WHO. So we'll put the links for that in as well.
All right.
So that people can go to the website and find out, well, what can I do? Because there is a move afoot and there is an international move afoot as well. Mm. Children's Health Defence, US, that I am now linked with because we now have a Children's Health Defence Australia chapter and I'm the chair and director of that. So Children's Health Defence US are also moving on this. So we do have movement and other countries are as well. So there is movement happening, but there needs more. We don't have a lot of time on this
one. All right. Thanks for coming in and terrific to talk
about. Thank you, Cam.